So this is a lecture one in engineering mechanics. So we are going to put it in the YouTube so that everybody can see. So I dedicate this engineering mechanics series, lecture series, to two persons from whom I got much. Okay. So one of them is T. Sudhakar, currently he has taken you the introduction to your mechanics, mechanical engineering course, branch specific course. So he is a person, you know, is knowledgeable in many areas, and whenever we want to discuss something, we will go and discuss with him. So I have framed much, I gained many things from him about this subject, and as well as the thing, I dedicate this. And also I dedicate this to my mentor, Professor C. R. Kandasamy. So he is not alive, but he was a professor in the production engineering department. He had a PhD degree from Moscow. Okay. Now coming to the engineering mechanics. So we have to, before going to the subject itself, we have to locate or see where this subject stands. Okay, engineering mechanics, whether it is an origin, whether it is connected with other subject, that helps a little bit. So here, see, suddenly we are introducing engineering mechanics. So how this is connected? This is all connected. So it's the origin of this mechanics. Mechanics is part of physics. So physics, you have, you know, number of things. You have the electricity coming under this, and you have a lot of other subjects. So mechanics is one of the subjects in physics. So in mechanics, you know that mechanics in physics itself basically starts with the number of the thing started with the persons like the Archimedes. Okay, so you have a number of people you have contributed to this mechanics. So first we call it as the certain mechanics, group of mechanics or whatever is discussed is called classical. Why it is classical? Because this mechanics was developed over the years, and it could not answer certain the problems in physics or phenomena in physics. So when it comes to the phenomena of things happening at a very small level, the atomic levels, so the classical mechanics has no answer. So they have the new type of mechanics was developed called quantum mechanics. Then the quantum mechanics is something deals with a very small level, the atomic level or very small particles level, so it is able to adjust, whereas the classical mechanics assume that energy level exists, you know, in every, it is continuously existing, but as quantum mechanics says that energy level can exist in certain levels only, in a discrete levels, not in a continuous way. So this is one mechanics called quantum mechanics, where several people have contributed to this. So it is able to answer certain things which could not be answered by classical mechanics. Then when it comes to the speed, very high speeds or speeds related to the close to the light, classical mechanics could not answer. So there is a new kind of mechanics called relativistic mechanics. So the contributor to the relativistic mechanics is Einstein. Okay. So for classical mechanics, there are people who have contributed. So basically, we can say the classical mechanics is the basic foundations are from Archimedes, then Galileo, then you have the Newton. So we in general people call it the Newton. This classical mechanics has two ways of answering or solving the problems. One is direct approach. Another thing is called indirect approach. In the direct approach, we use the Newton's law. So it is called Newton. It is using the force. You should know the force and you can find out what is the accelerations, etc. That is called a direct approach. Indirect approach uses the energy. So the energy principles are used. So here we have the two basic ways of solving the problem. Is one is a Hamilton. Another is Lagrange. So if you look at physics, mechanics is a subject in physics which deals with the forces and its action on the bodies, and so we deal with that, the study of that. Then that is divided into the classical, quantum and relativistic mechanics. Then in classical mechanics, we have the direct approach and indirect approach. Direct approach comes from Newton. The other indirect approach is Hamilton and Lagrange. So here, this is about how we discuss it when you say it is a part of the physics. Now, when it comes to this, the classical can answer many of your problems. Even though you say that classical could not work in certain areas like dealing with the problems of small particles or things which are very moving at a very high speeds, but anything falls in between can be answered by classical mechanics. So engineers, as engineers, you know, we work in this domain. We don't go into very small particles or this thing. Mechanical engineers work with some objects which could be visible or which can be handled. So those things can be solved by the principles which are developed in the classical mechanics. Okay. So in the classical mechanics, again, at the level of UG, we will be using the direct approach. Okay. Direct approach is the one we use most of the times. Okay. Now, when it comes to this, the direct, this is about physics. So this still remains in the physics form. Now, how this engineering mechanics is coming? Okay. So that is what we have to look at. So how this engineering mechanics is coming here. So what we do as an engineer is we apply. We take those principles. We want to the main. If you Sudhar would have defined you what is the role of an engineer or what is engineering, what is mechanical engineering, all this. But when it comes to the engineering, I would say the a simple way. Our aim is to increase the quality of life of the society. Okay. So we do whatever, you know, we apply the principles that were developed by the scientists to the benefit of the society. Okay. So that is what we do. So we are going to apply whatever we do. So there it comes, the application. We can say that applied mechanics. So in the case of applied mechanics, then the applied mechanics is, you know, when it is on about the solids or it is about the fluids. In the solids, whether the solids you are going to consider, they are rigid or they are deformable. So these things are there. Now, what is this, what is the difference between this, you know, the treating the classical mechanics or the these things as a part of, you know, the physics, that is in the science domain and engineering domain. So here I would like to take a small example of this. What is it? Say for example, I have a problem. The problem is like, you know, I have a mass m, it is initially at a velocity, zero velocity, and it has to be, there is a force is applied on this, the force is applied on this, and I need this mass to have a particular velocity. Okay, so I say this is V1, this is V2, this is the same mass m. The distance is x. So I have a mass which is at a zero velocity, a force is acting on that, that is a distance x, so it has to reach the velocity v. So now I want to find out what is the force to be applied. If V2 is fixed, V1 is 0, to attain a particular velocity V where the distance x is fixed, what should be the force? You can calculate it because you have done it. You know what is the for the principles to be used to solve the problem. Right? Or I can frame this in a different way. Like F is known, then what should be the x to attain a particular velocity v2? You can solve the problem. It's not a problem. It's not an issue at all. With whatever the inputs you have already, you can solve the problem. So this is a physics problem. The same thing if I say that I don't worry about this mass. I say there is an aircraft. This distance is runway distance. So I'm talking about an aircraft of certain mass, and I know the runway distances of the various airports. Then I decided the mass of the aircraft is such this because it has to carry so many tons. Okay, so the weight or the mass of this aircraft is decided. I know from the data what are the various lengths of the thing. I have to take the minimum runway length on the airport I wanted to land. Then I know the takeoff velocity. So if these things are known, I have to select the engines which can give the necessary force, the thrust force. What engines you have to select? So you are in a aircraft designing, the same problem changes into applied problem wherein you are dealing with the real things. Like it's not ideal mass, it is an aircraft, the weight of the aircraft is this much. Then you know the runway length, they are fixed. So you have to find out the least the runway. You know what is the takeoff velocity of the aircraft. Then you can select the jet engine thrust. Can you calculate the jet engine thrust to be some particular fraction value and say that you designed the engine? No. You can go back to the table of the aircraft manufacturers like Rolls-Royce or GE and choose a particular engine. Okay, so here some data, if I say now, say for example, what is the length of the runway? Length of the runway approximately is, say it is from 3 to 2.2 kilometers. Then what is the aircraft weight? Suppose I say I am talking about 777 aircraft, it is about 350 tons. Okay, so I replace this mass with an aircraft, that is 777, then it is going to be 350 tons. Then what is the takeoff velocity? Takeoff velocity of jetliners is something like 250 kilometers per hour. Okay, Now you see, the problem is, I have the aircraft, I have decided the weight of the aircraft, what is the carrying capacity of the aircraft and weight. So it is going to be 777. Then if I want to choose the jet engine, I can choose like this. Or the same problem in a different way. The different way is like, you have the aircraft and the jet capacity, everything is fixed. You are going to build an airport, then you can decide on what is the runway length. I cannot have a shorter runway length or unnecessarily a long runway in which, you know, I'll be wasting a lot of time, a lot of money. Okay, so this I would say is a problem where, if you take simply as a mass, velocity v1, v2, x, find out what is this f required, or find out what is x required. That is a physics problem, basic simple physics problem. Suppose you do the same thing for this, taking in what is exactly available. Don't just take an aircraft of weight, you know, about 16 tons. Nonsense. The problem should not be, you know, an aircraft of 16 tons. 16 tons is the weight of a fully loaded truck, lorry. I should not say that that is equal to the weight of this. So you have to take something realistic, what is available. 777. Suppose you can also be, that could be a problem. Given the data about Trichy airport, whether you know, 787, okay, 787, I'm sorry, A380, whether A380 can land. A380 is the Boeing, not Boeing, you know, this Airbus A380 is a double-decker aircraft, huge one, which approximately is about 600 tons. So you can, if you know the thrust, if you know the takeoff velocity, you can, if you know the data of the runway length of this this thing, you can say whether it can land or not. Okay, so these things you can do. You can do it, whatever knowledge you have already acquired in physics, and you apply it. But if you stay with the same simple mass, this thing, then you are not going to be an engineer. Okay, just apply whatever you are doing here. That is what. So our problems here in engineering mechanics will be something like this, application oriented, which is will be connected to what is something which is physical. Okay, now coming back here, in the applied mechanics we can deal with the solids or fluids. Okay, and when it comes to the fluids, it is called fluid mechanics. So where you may be dealing with the ideal fluids, a viscous, then, or it can be compressible. So in your curriculum, you are going to learn all this about fluid mechanics. There is a fluid mechanics course is there, where you will be dealing with the incompressible fluids, and you will also be dealing with the viscous fluids. Then you will also be dealing with the compressible fluid flow and jet propulsion. There is a subject is there where you will be studying this. Now coming to the solids, you can think of a solid as a rigid one where it cannot deform, or it can deform. So when you say the body on which the forces are acting, it is capable of deforming, then you can talk about its strength and all this thing. This is a subject called strength of materials. But if I say in a general, I will not consider the deformation, I will consider this as a rigid body, so that lot of simplification can be obtained. So if you consider this as a rigid body, then this is your engineering mechanics. Okay, so now you know the path, how it is connected, with the physics. Now the applied mechanics, where you are standing, now we are going to study strength of material. There is another subject is there. So engineering mechanics is a another subject. Okay, so we are going to restrict ourselves mostly to bodies which cannot deform, that is the rigid bodies. Okay, if you have any questions, you can ask. Now we are into the engineering mechanics. So that also is a division, subdivisions. So when it comes to engineering mechanics, it is divided into statics and dynamics. Statics and dynamics. Statics is when there will not be any motion. If it is a way to simplify, say there won't be any motion. It is a, you know, the crude way to say. Okay. Dynamics is where there is a motion is involved. So we are going to define it perfectly, but let us see this. So there won't be any time parameter in statics where there is a variable, time variable involved in this. Okay, so we hereafter go into the definitions what is stated in this book. I told you that we are going to follow the engineering mechanics by Timoshenko and Young, the book. Timoshenko is a very big contributor to this field. So he has written number of books. He has written books on strength of materials as well. He has written books on theory of elasticity, plates and shells. So finally everybody has said that okay, you have contributed enough and you should be called the father of engineering mechanics. Okay, so he is the father of engineering mechanics. So that is Timoshenko. So we are going by the original text, so by original source what this says. So statics, according to this definition, the first sentence, statics deals with the conditions of equilibrium of bodies acted upon by forces. Okay, so we are talking about equilibrium of bodies acted upon by forces. Acted upon by forces, okay. So equilibrium is a very important term, whether a body is in equilibrium or not. So equilibrium means a net force is acting on it, zero, so there is no motion possible, because according to Newton, there should be a net force for it to accelerate. So here we don't have anything, so we have a zero force. So that is whether it is body is in equilibrium. We deal with several things which are supposed to be in equilibrium, otherwise we'll be in great danger. For example, this building, the building is not supposed to have a motion. Or a wind blows, if it oscillates like this, or suddenly if it collapses, it's dangerous. So we have a civil structure. Many of the civil structures like bridges or your buildings are to be in static equilibrium. Irrespective of the forces acting on it, it should be in equilibrium. Okay, so that is called a statics. When dynamics is there, there will be a net force acting on it, so it will be undergoing the motion. So here again it is divided into two. It is called kinetics, kinematics and kinetics. Kinematics is something, you know, we talk about the motions as such, that is its displacement, it is velocity, it is acceleration, but we don't consider or worry about the forces that is causing the motion or the torque which is causing this motion. Okay, So when it comes to the kinematics, we don't talk about the forces at all, what is causing. We will simply talk about the motion only. That is called kinematics. So in your subject, in your curriculum, the subject called Mechanics of Machines 1 is totally on kinematic. We don't talk about a force at all. We don't utter a single word about the force. We discuss about gears. We discuss about how the gears will transmit motion, etc. But we don't talk about the force. We don't consider what causes the gears to rotate. So that is called kinematics. But when we talk about kinetics also, the forces involved in causing them, then it is in your curriculum, it is Mechanics of Machine 2. You see, your curriculum covers most of the things in mechanics. You are going to study engineering mechanics now, where you will be talking about this, statics and a little bit of principles of dynamics. Then that you will apply also into the Mechanics of Machine 1 and the Mechanics of Machine 2. This engineering mechanics principles will be carried to solve the problems in your other aspect, like your strength of materials also. Then you will also, it will be used in fluid mechanics. Okay, so this is a very fundamental subject. So if you are comfortable with it, you can deal the other subjects which are going to come in the higher semesters with ease. Otherwise, it will be a problem. Now, you have any questions? Now we are going into the subject. Now we are going to define one by one, discuss about that. So let us take first the assumption or the rigidity or rigid body. So what is a rigid body? When you call a body as a rigid body, please, yes.
Distance between any two points within the body remains constant.
Yeah, exactly. It's a perfect, the technical definition. Okay? If you take a body, so when I say a rigid body, I will like to draw the rigid body not in this elegant way of a perfect geometry of a rectangle or a circle or a square. When you say a rigid body, every time I draw only a circle or a rectangular thing or this thing, then you may tend to think that a rigid body will have some regular geometric shape. Okay, so whenever rigid body is discussed, whenever we try to represent the rigid body, what we do is we draw something like this, an arbitrary shape. Is also, I would like to caution, it is not necessary that it has to be like this with irregular shape. It can be having a regular shape. But any book, if you say something is drawn like this as a body, then it is an arbitrary shape. It can have a regular shapes as well, regular geometry as well. Okay, so if you want to say this body is rigid, one of the important thing is every body, if you take any body, even the non-rigid body will be considered as rigid if no external forces are acting on it. If I take something, don't apply any force, what is the problem? So when forces are acting on them, you have to test the character of it. When an external force is acting, not a single force, a net force will be acting on it. This body is in equilibrium, it will not be moving. The net force is acting on this, and if it is not deforming, if the shape is not changing, then it is a rigid body. More technical definition, as he said, is, that's a very good definition. We say we take any two points on this, any two points. So I can take the third points as well. You measure this distance, the distance must be same. So if I say this is point A, this is B and C, if I draw this position, if I measure the position by a position vector, they must, these position vectors must be constant irrespective of the force condition, irrespective of the forces which are acting on it. It's not that when you have zero force, even your very elastic rubber ball also will retain its shape if there is no body is acting. Suppose a force is acting on this rubber ball, it will show its character, two characters, it will shape the changes, the shape. Okay, you can squeeze a rubber ball, soft rubber ball you can squeeze, but it is difficult to squeeze a steel ball. But the argument is different. Even you take a rigid the steel ball and apply forces, there will be deformation. But the deformations will be too small to be observed. Okay? So can we say that a rigid body is a one where the deformation is too small to observe? No. Or even if you take any rigid body, if you apply greater force, you can have a observable deformation. Okay? So let me say, put it like this, a rigid body is the one where you can say, you can think of, when you apply a force, even a little force you apply, deformation will be there, but deformations will be too small to observe. Or if you apply a very great force, the great forces will definitely have a observable deformation. Then you will see that no material in this world will have the quality of a rigid body. So rigid body is an idealization. We consider the body is rigid, then it is an idealization. For convenience, we idealize it, so easily you can solve. Many of the problems can be solved with this idealization. You are not going to violate much. Okay? So a rigid body is the one wherein any, even if the action of external forces, it is not undergoing any deformation. That means technically the distance between any point, any two points on this is going to be, or any between any points on this is going to be conserved. It's not going to, it is an invariant. Okay? It's not going to change with respect to time. So it is an invariant. Now that is a rigid body assumption. How it helps? How this assumption helps? So there is an example given in the book itself. For example, that example is this. You have a steel a bar like this, and two masses are hanging, say M1, M2. So you have something like this, and you hang two masses, and it is in you find that it is not moving, that means it is in equilibrium. If you want to do the calculations, what you do is you know the masses M1, M2. You can find out what is the weight of these two, the forces acting on it. Then coming to the distance, you take this distance. Even in before applying the load, whatever the distance you have, that distance you will take it as a constant, isn't it? Whatever, even if you increase the masses here, what distance you will take, you will continue to take same distance, like say this is L1, this is L2, you will continue to take L1 and L2. But in fact, if you closely observe it, that is not correct, because of this weight, this is going to deform a little, even if I exaggerate it. So this will be my true shape of it. This is going to be a deformed. Because as we know that no material in the world can be rigid, so there will be a deformation. So what is the length that I can take? It is not the length in an undeformed condition. You have to take the deformed length only. It is very difficult to find that deformed length. But if you assume that this is a rigid one, you have a convenience of taking the undeformed length of these L1 and L2 and come do the computations. So we assume in engineering mechanics most of the times these things are rigid. Okay, rigid things helps me in solving the problem because these kind of nuisance will not be there. I need not take a deformed length over this to solve the problem. Okay, any doubts? Okay, we discussed about something called a rigid body. Now the next concept that we have to discuss is we have just said statics deals with the condition of the rigid bodies acted upon by forces, equilibrium of bodies acted upon by forces. One of the thing is we assume this is a rigid body, and what about the forces? So now we have to talk about a force. So can we say what is a force? If you are asked a simple question, what is a force? Can you write down, everyone take 1 or 2 minutes and write down, what do you think your answer would be for the question, what is a force?
போதும் கட்டிடுங்களா, கட்டிடலாம், நானும் அப்படியே கட்டிட்டு கொண்டு வந்து போதும்.
ஓகே, கம் அவுட் வித் ஆன்சர்ஸ். எனி ஒன் கேன் ரீட், வாட் யூ திங்க் ஆஃப் இட் இஸ் அ ஃபோர்ஸ்? யா ப்ளீஸ்.
A
physical? Feel, okay. You say a force is a field which can deform. Okay. Now, anybody else? Yeah.
Force is a push or pull which can cause acceleration in the body.
Oh, it is a push or pull. It's a push or pull which can cause acceleration of a body. You said it is a feel and it can deform, right? Okay. Any other answers which is not falling in this? Yeah. Changing the state of the body. Okay. Same thing. Changing the state of the body. Okay. Try to change or change the state of the body. Any other? Okay, I will start with this answer itself. So the first gentleman said that it is a field which can deform. The force can deform, and in that case, will there be any acceleration? There may be an acceleration or may not be an acceleration.
The body may deform, sir. The body may not have an acceleration.
Yeah.
The point of deformation.
Oh, the point of deformation can have an acceleration. Okay. What about the next one? This is, you say it is an acceleration, that there is no necessity for the deformation. Okay. Let me take one example where you have a block and it is on a surface where there is a friction. Then you are applying a force F which overcomes the friction force small f. And you know that this can cause the displacement of this. Now you see that there is a force involved, and if you consider it is a sufficiently rigid body, it need not deform, and there is no acceleration. But what this force do? There is a force, right? There is a force, you are applying a force. So what this force do? It is not accelerating, it is not deforming. It is a condition where there is no acceleration involved, there is no deformation involved, but something else is involved, that is the force is doing the work. If you say that the displacement occurred is x, f into x is work. So if you are say I'm moving this table, means what I do is I don't accelerate it. There is no acceleration involved, there is no the deformation involved, but what this force has done is it has displaced it, it has done work. The work is involved here. So what is the thing? There is one more term here, is the deform. See, feel. He said ever feel. Do human beings have the feeling of the force? Can you feel the force? Tell me. Otherwise, everybody, pinch yourself and see whether you are able to feel the force or not. If you are not feeling, something problem. Don't pinch others, pinch yourself. So when you have a feeling, you can sense the force, but it is the answer is not the full yes or no. When a force is applied on you, you are involved in some kind of a contact, you can feel the forces. But if somebody is hitting the other person, or somebody is putting the hand, so for example, I am just putting the hand on this, you will not be able to say whether applying a force or not, whether I am pulling or pushing. I may be just touching here without applying any force. So human beings don't have the feeling of the force, the sensory perception of the force when it is applied on them. But it is not universal, saying that there is you are watching some lorry is accelerating, by seeing that you say forces are acting, though total force, friction force, you are able to see there, this is another force is acting, so the net force is in this direction, so the lorry is going to accelerate. Are you able to see that by looking at it? No. So it is not you will not be able to see the forces and their interactions when it is acted upon on others or other bodies. What you can have is something when it is acted upon you, you can feel. Okay, and also it has a restriction. You don't have qualitative this thing. You cannot say immediately what is the difference between 5 kg of weight, then, or you may not be able to differentiate between 10 Newton and 10.1 Newton. It's very difficult. Okay, our perception is limited. Okay, we may have this as a pain a little bit, but not, you may not be able to quantify exactly what it is. Right. Now with these things, if I say, what is the definition of the force? Or what is a force? How will you answer that? It is a push or pull, it is a layman term. Yes, it is true, it is a push or pull. It is trying to modify its condition of state. Yes, what is the condition of state modified? If there is a displacement, it is a condition is modified. If there is a velocity without acceleration also, it is modified. So what is a force? It's a feeling. No, it's not a feeling, because we cannot feel. Okay? So when it comes to the force, you can define the force by what it causes, what is the effect of the force. Okay? You cannot directly define this is the force. Okay, that is a force. We don't have a visualization for that, but we can say the force by its effect. Okay, what it can cause. So I can say, if something is accelerating, we can say there is a net force is acting on this in the direction of acceleration. I can say by the effect. Okay, the force can cause, force can be realized by its effect. So what are the effects of the force? So the effects, what are the things the force can do? One is that it can accelerate. It can accelerate the body. When a force is acting on it, as per the Newton's law, it is going to accelerate in the direction of the net force. We know that when we press the accelerator pedal, the speed of the vehicle is going to increase. That means there is an acceleration. When you apply the brake, we know that the reverse is going to happen. That is a deceleration. It can also deform. When it can deform, is that there are situations in which there is no acceleration. Say a body is in equilibrium. So if I say that I have a chalk piece and I am pressing against it, what kind of this force I am applying through the chalk piece, acting on this board, is not accelerating the board, because the board can offer the necessary opposite reaction and the total system is in equilibrium. So under the static conditions, what this force is doing? The force is keeping the system in equilibrium, but in real world we know that no body is completely rigid. So what you can think of is it can deform. Okay? So that is what in a static equilibrium cases, what the work force you can see, how you realize the force is the force can deform. Sometimes the deformation is realizable or visual, sometimes it is not. But if you see that the forces can deform, or put these things in equilibrium, keep the things in equilibrium, then it can do work. It can do work. The force can do work. In that case, something can be moved without acceleration, without the deformation, but it can move. You apply the force, you push a cart, it will move. You have a cycle, take your cycle, move it like this. What happens is, you are moving the cycle. What you are doing is, you are doing work. You are the cycle need not be accelerating, but it is moving at a constant velocity, but you are doing work against the frictional forces. Okay, one thing I used to say is, suppose you lock the cycle and try to move, you have to put a greater force to do that, because the wheel is locked. Now the static friction comes into effect instead of a rolling friction. So what you are doing there is that force what you applied on the cycle is to overcome the friction. It is doing the work. Okay? Then there is one more effect, is that wherever some turning is there, you can see there is a force involved. Suppose you are turning a wheel A steering wheel is there, you turn the steering wheel. What you do is, there is no acceleration of this wheel, there is no work you are doing, but it is also, it can, in that case, it is producing a torque. It can produce moment. Whenever you think of a moment, the moment is a force into the shortest distance, moment arm. So that is, forces are involved in producing moment. So when it comes to what is a force, you can say force can be the felt by the causes or what it does, the effect of the forces. It can accelerate, it can do work, then it can deform, and also it can produce moment. Okay, this you cannot find in the books. So this is the thinking of Sudhakar. Then he has come out with this inclusive definition of the force. Okay, you can, you have any more things to add? If you are able to refine it, is better. It is not the end of it. You are able to refine, contribute to this, the refinement of this definition, we welcome. Okay, so I think when you put this way, the conflicts will not come. Say somebody is saying the change of the state, it can accelerate, and they say there are situations when it does work, yes, there is a force involved which does the work. You can clearly say that in every situation. Now the second part of it, okay, how will you specify the a force? What do you mean by that specification of the force? Say somebody may pushing something here, a heavier man will try to push greater, but how will you differentiate between this? Magnitude? Okay, magnitude of the effect. So how will you specify force? Before going to this, say for example, how will you specify an automobile? For example, two-wheeler, you say, how will you specify an automobile? Say somebody asks what two-wheeler you have. You have to specify it, no? How will you specify it? What is the model you have? I have a Bajaj Avenger. Okay, somebody may say it is a KTM, or somebody say it is a Hero Honda, this model, Splendor. So that tells everything. That is the specification. If both of them is having same model, Hero, Splendor, then how would you specify? How old it is? No, you can give the registration number. So as a student, how you are specified as per the administration is concerned, you are all given roll number. But out of this roll number, if you want to specify a human being, what you will say is gender, whether it is a male or female. Next, what is his height? What is the weight? And so on, you can, what is the color? Okay, then you can go on to say that what is the color of your eyes, all these things you can extend. That's not a issue. So this is what we call a specification, to distinguish between one with the other. If everything is same, then we can say both are same, right? So when it comes to the question of how to specify a force, as one gentleman has said, that one of the specification of the force is its magnitude. Magnitude. The magnitude of the force, it is related to, you know, how much acceleration it can produce on a particular mass. If I take one mass, and for example, I have a mass of M, there is a force F1 is acting on this at one instant. Now I remove this F1, apply F2. How do I find the magnitude of F1 and F2? How do I distinguish between F1 and F2 in terms of magnitude? There you know that Newton's first law says that is F is equal to ma. So a is the acceleration. How much acceleration it can produce? Okay, how much acceleration it can produce? If F1 produces greater acceleration, say for example, when F1 is acted upon it, F1 produces an acceleration of a1 on the mass m, F2 produces an acceleration of a2. If a2 is greater than a1, you know that F2 applied is greater than F1. So you can quantify the force by the acceleration it causes on a particular mass. So we need not have different people talking about different masses. We can just take a specified mass, standardized mass. We would like to standardize these measurements, because when you say magnitude, that magnitude specified by one person and other specified person should mean the same, should not be different. So that's what we call it as a standardization. So when it comes to the standardization of this force measurement, we take mass m as 1 kg. So if you apply a force that produces an acceleration of 1 meter per second square, then applied force is unit quantity, that is called 1 newton. The magnitude of the force is defined by the acceleration it causes. Okay, so if I say 1 newton means, if I take 1 kg mass, apply 1 newton force, the acceleration should be 1 meter per second square. Or in other words, I'd say 1 newton is a force required to accelerate 1 kg mass by 1 meter per second square. It is called 1 newton. Okay, so how do you measure this these forces? Okay, this is the thing. How do I measure the forces? I cannot, need not be having always 1 newton. I cannot have only 1 kg. If I say there is a mass of, you know, 10 kg, I cannot say that you have to split it into 1 kg unit, then only I will be able to find out what and say that this is the newton. No. So for measuring, we have measuring devices. Some of the measuring devices are like, you know, the spring balance. We have a spring balance here. We have some indication when you apply here. I am applying a force. I am pulling it, stretching it, you know. So there is a needle which goes. Now it indicates about 3 kg. The unit here is kg. Okay. So this is a spring balance which is used for weighing purposes. This is another weighing balances. So when you load something here, it deflects, isn't it? What is the unit here? It is in grams. This also another device here. It is called a force dynamometer. You can see that, you know, by pulling this, I'm applying greater force. The dial, the indicates different values, right? So now I'm applying, say, probably 0.5 newton. So it directly, the unit here is newton, whereas this is in kg. So whether it measures the mass or the force, okay, whether this measures the mass or the force, here it is very clear it measures the force, because it is given in terms of newton. If I put this on a red circle, then if I whatever I apply is going to be doubled. Here now I am applying 2 newtons. So you have two scales here, black and red. So if you want to get the readings in the red, you have to put this, the thread, you run the thread over the red pulley, otherwise you run the thread on the this thing. So what it has basically is an elastic device. You have a torsional spring which measures the torque, and that is calibrated to give you the force. And here we have a spring balance. So these are all the some force measuring devices which are commonly available. Now this is, it doesn't cost much, you know, some 500 rupees you get this. It measures the force applied. I'm applying the force, but what it indicates? It indicates grams. Okay, mass. So we will discuss about this in the next class. Then we will continue our discussion. With that, we stop.